Hello everybody. Today in this session, we will discuss the renal function tests or the RFT. We can divide the topic into two halves. In the first half, we will discuss about the factors by which we can assess the kidney diseases commonly in our clinical setting. These are the serum analysis and the urine examination. One is the serum analysis and one is the urine examination. Under this urine examination, we will have routine assessment as well as culture sensitivity test. In the next half, we will discuss about the procedure to assess the functional status of the kidney. In this section, we will discuss mainly on the filtration capacity of the glomerulus. Next is the permeability of the glomerular capillary network and the glomerular basement membrane. And finally, the tubular functional assessment by checking the specific gravity of urine. So let's start with the serum analysis. So in this serum analysis, in our day-to-day clinical setting, we will mainly check few parameters. These are commonly checked parameters are number one, blood urea, and its normal range is 10 to 45 milligram per dl. Then is the serum creatinine or creatine. Its normal range is 0.5 to 1.5 milligram per dl. Then serum sodium ion concentration. Its normal range is almost 130 to 145 milliequivalent per liter. Then we will have serum potassium ion, and its normal range is 3.5 to 6.5 milliequivalent per liter. Then we will have blood urea nitrogen. How we can check blood urea nitrogen? To simplify this test, we can use the formula, that is the serum urea value multiply with the 0.47 factor. And its normal range is almost 5 to 26 milligram per dl. So 5 to 26 milligram per dl. Now few points regarding the blood urea nitrogen. Increment in the blood urea nitrogen value more than 26 milligram per dl is known as azotemia. So what does it mean? Azotemia. Azotemia denotes the increased blood urea nitrogen concentration. Most typically it can be seen in case of chronic kidney diseases. So what are the diseases which can increase the blood urea nitrogen? These are mainly the congestive cardiac failure, chronic kidney disease, or the bilateral ureteral obstruction, bilateral ureter if it is obstructed. So bilateral ureteral obstruction. Then is the bladder outlet obstruction, bladder outlet obstruction. So these are the clinical entity where you can get this blood urea nitrogen increment. Where you can get this decreased blood urea nitrogen? So the diseases mainly where there will be increase in the extracellular volume. So expansion of the extracellular volume or the volume overload diseases, as well as in case of sudden inappropriate antidiuretic hormone secretion, that is the SIADH, S-I-A-D-H disease. So in these two conditions, you can get this decreased blood urea nitrogen. One important note regarding blood urea and creatinine. Out of this blood urea and creatinine, which one is more sensitive to assess the chronic kidney disease? Of course, it is the creatine. Why? Because creatine is the first serum parameter which can increase during the chronic kidney disease. But you will get increased serum urea concentration in laboratory assessment only when there will be more than 50% of the nephron will be damaged. So more than 50% nephron destruction or non-functioning will lead to increase in the urea concentration. But in the very early stage, only blood urea, blood creatinine will be increased. So that is the difference between the blood urea and creatinine. And this is the take home message. Next, our newer serum markers are such as serum cystatin C. Serum cystatin C. This is the newer blood parameter or blood marker, which can mainly used to assess the glomerular filtration, and its normal range is almost 0.8 to 1.2 milligram per DL. Next, the newer parameter is the albumin creatinine ratio, which is also known as ACR. So albumin creatinine ratio or ACR means what? Albumin creatinine ratio or the ACR value, its normal range is how much? Its normal range, it helps to detect, or it has some diagnostic value and has some prognostic value. So in case of vascular endothelial dysfunction, it has the diagnostic value. In case of vascular endothelial dysfunction, it has diagnostic value. Whereas in case of diabetes mellitus, hypertension, these are the common diseases where you can use this albumin creatinine ratio for the as a prognostic marker, or the post streptococcal glomerulonephritis. So in short, diabetes mellitus, hypertension, as well as post streptococcal glomerulonephritis are the diseases where you can use this albumin creatinine ratio as a prognostic marker. Along with that, you can also use it to assess the risk factor for the venous thromboembolism. So venous thromboembolism risk factor can also be done, assessment can also be done by this ACR. So venous thromboembolism, these two are newer parameters. Next important newer blood marker or parameter you can say is the BUN creatinine ratio, blood urea nitrogen creatinine ratio. And its normal range, or the it can say, you can say it is a BCR. Here its normal range is almost 12:1 to 20:1. And this is the important parameter or blood marker to assess the acute kidney injury. That means it will increase in case of acute kidney injury. That means if someone will ask you which one is the best blood parameter or blood marker to assess acute kidney injury, no doubt it is the BUN creatinine ratio. Now we will come to the urine analysis. Next we will discuss about the urine analysis. So in this urine analysis, we can check the routine examination as well as the microscopic examination and the culture sensitivity test. So RDME and the culture sensitivity are the test under this urine analysis part. So in the routine assessment, what are the factors that we will need to check in the urine routine examination? So routine examination or the gross urinary examination factors are, number one is the volume. All we know that the normal urine output in human is how much? It is almost 500 ml to 2.5 liter per day. And if it is less than 400 ml per day, it is known as oliguria. So oliguria means when the urine output will be less than 400 ml per day. When it is less than 100 ml per day, it is known as anuria. and when it is more than 3 liter per day, it is known as polyuria. Now, where we can get this oliguria and anuria? Most typically, it can be seen in case of renal failure or renal shutdown. When there is renal shutdown problem, there will be anuria. And polyuria, mainly or commonly, we can get in case of diabetes insipidus, which can be nephrogenic and neurogenic diabetes insipidus. Next, we have to check the color. So, normal urine color is what? It is, of course, a little bit yellowish. Why? Because presence of this urochrome pigment will make our urine yellowish. Where you can get high color or dark colored urine? So high color or the dark colored urine will produce in case of obstructive jaundice. In case of obstructive jaundice, which is also known as chloric jaundice, where you can get light color or pale color urine, pale or light color urine, it can be seen in case of hemolytic jaundice due to hemolytic anemia, commonly autoimmune hemolytic anemia. So hemolytic jaundice, you will get this pale or light colored urine, and this is known as, that's why it is known as achloric jaundice. So achloric jaundice or the hemolytic jaundice can produce pale or light colored urine. Now you can see the other colors also, like the black color. Black colored urine mainly occur in case of alkaptonuria. Alkaptonuria. In case of alkaptonuria disease, if you will keep the urine in the light source or under the sunlight, it will turn black because of increased concentration of the homogentisic acid value. Homogentisic acid increased concentration will lead to black colored urine in case of alkaptonuria, which is a type of inborn error of metabolism. So inborn error of metabolism can be seen in case of, typically, of course, in case of children or in case of newborn age group. Now we can, you have to check is the factor is the pH. So what is the normal range of the pH of the urine? It is almost 5 to 6.5, and the limiting pH we know is how much? Limiting pH is around 4.5. So all the time our urinary pH will be a little bit acidic because of excess load of the non-volatile acid in our body. That will make our urinary pH a little bit acidic. But under some physiological circumstances, you can get alkaline urine. So what are the factors or what are the causes that can produce alkaline urinary pH, or urinary pH will be higher than the 7.4. These are the during hyperventilation. Hyperventilation. So in case of hyperventilation, you can get alkaline urine. After taking meal, which is also known as postprandial alkaline tide, after taking meal, or which is also known as postprandial alkaline tide, you can get postprandial alkaline tide, you can get alkaline urine. Along with that, in case of high altitude, you also get alkaline urine. So in case of hyperventilation, in case of after taking meal, as well as in the high altitude, normally under the physiological circumstances, you will get this alkaline urine. Next, you have to check the specific gravity. So specific gravity assessment can be done either by the concentration method or the dilution method. And what is the normal range of the specific gravity? It is usually between 1001 to 1050, but in some cases normal range is between 0.1010 to 1025, and this specific gravity can be increased in case of glycosuria. So in case of glycosuria, specific gravity can be increased, or in case of proteinuria also the specific gravity can be increased. Specific gravity can be reduced in case of diabetes insipidus. So in case of diabetes insipidus, the specific gravity can be reduced. If you get specific gravity exactly 1010 value, that is the 1010 value, it is known as fixed specific gravity. It has critical importance, fixed specific gravity. So fixed specific gravity mainly can be seen in case of chronic kidney disease. So this is the clinical importance of the fixed specific gravity. Next, we have to assess the microscopic examination. So under this microscopic examination heading, mainly we have to check some elements, elemental factors, as well as the chemical constituents, chemical agents. So what are those elements? First we will discuss this thing. So under this elemental contents, there will be mainly, so elements are basically castes. Then we will have epithelial cells, which can normally be present. So epithelial cells, which can normally present. Next is the pus cell, which is basically dead leukocytes. Pus cells are known as dead leukocytes, and its normal range is 4 to 10 per high power field. 4 to 10 pus cell per high power field. And if you will get more than 10 pus cells per high power field, that means there will be urinary tract infection. So in case of UTI commonly, you will get this more than 10 pus cells per high power field. Next important constituent under the elemental factors are the RBC or the hemoglobin or the hemosiderin. If you will get normal shape and size of the RBC in the urine, that means there will be ongoing urinary tract injury, or the in case of acute kidney injury, you will get the normal shape size RBC in the urine. If we will get hemoglobin in the urine, which is also known as hemoglobinuria. So hemoglobinuria can be present in case of acute hemolysis, acute hemolytic condition. So in case of acute hemolysis, you will get hemoglobin in the urine. And hemosiderin, if you will get it into the urine, it is known as hemosiderinuria. And this hemosiderinuria or presence of hemosiderin in the urine denotes chronic hemolysis. So this is the basic difference between the acute and chronic hemolysis. In case of acute hemolysis, you will get hemoglobinuria. In case of chronic hemolysis, you will get hemosiderinuria. And if there will be acute kidney injury, you will get normal shape size RBC. But if the RBC size will be altered, which is known as dysmorphic RBC. So dysmorphic RBC, if it is present in the urine, that means it denotes nephritic condition or the nephritis syndrome. syndrome. So nephritic syndrome or the nephritis can basically occur when you will get dysmorphic RBC. Now come to the point of the casts. Casts are basically solidified proteins or the TAM Hausfeld protein. Casts are basically solidified protein or the TAM Hausfeld protein. TAM Hausfeld protein is known as cast. And substances in the shape of the renal tubule are also known as casts. Substances that are present in the renal and in the shape of the renal tubule is also known as cast. So there are several variants of casts that you need to know. One is the hyaline cast. So hyaline cast can be present in case of nephrotic syndrome. Next is the RBC cast. Here it is RBC cast. It can be present in case of IgA nephropathy. IgA nephropathy. So IgA nephropathy is a clinical condition where you will get RBC cast in the urine. Next is the WBC cast. WBC cast can be seen in case of pyelonephritis. Pyelonephritis. Bacterial infection will lead to WBC cast in the urine. Next is the fatty cast with the oval bodies. Fatty cast with the oval bodies. So fatty cast with the oval bodies can be seen in case of severe nephrotic syndrome or the late stage of the nephrotic syndrome. Finally, you can get muddy brown granular cast. Muddy brown granular cast. So muddy brown granular cast can basically be seen in case of acute tubular necrosis. Acute tubular necrosis or in case of acute kidney injury, you will get muddy brown granular cast. So these are all about our cast. Next, we will discuss about the abnormal chemical constituents. So under these chemical constituents, chemical agents that can be present in the urine during the pathological condition, first we have to know is the glucose. So presence of glucose, or which is also known as glycosuria, can be seen in case of diabetes mellitus when plasma glucose value will be more than 250 to 300 milligram per dl, the glucose will come into the urine, which is known as glycosuria. And in case of diabetes mellitus, you can get this glycosuria. How we can detect glucose in the urine? Test known as Benedict test. So the test that is the Benedict's test can detect glucose in the urine. Next is the protein. Normally, presence of protein is known as proteinuria, and daily protein level in the urine should not be exceed more than 150 milligram per day. And how we can detect protein in the urine? This test is known as heat coagulation test. So heat coagulation test is the procedure by which you can detect protein in the urine. Next is the ketone bodies. Ketone bodies like acetone, acetoacetic acid, or the beta hydroxybutyric acid. Presence of ketone is known as ketonuria, and ketonuria is always a pathological condition and which can be seen in case of diabetic ketoacidosis. So diabetic ketoacidosis is the disease where you can get ketone bodies in the urine. Next abnormal constituent in the urine is the blood, and presence of blood can be detected by the Benzidine test. So Benzidine test is the procedure by which you can detect blood in the urine. Next is the bile salt. Bile salt and the bile pigment. Both bile salts and bile pigment can be seen in case of obstructive jaundice. Obstructive jaundice. Due to common bile duct obstruction, you can get the bile salt and bile pigment in the urine. How can you detect bile salt in the urine? The test is known as Hayes test. By the Hayes test, you can detect bile salt in the urine, and presence of bile pigment can be detected by the Fouchet's test. So Fouchet's test is the procedure by which you can detect bile pigment in the urine. Next important normal constituent is the hormone metabolites. Hormone metabolites. Important normal hormone metabolite in the urine is known as 17-ketosteroid, which is the byproduct of the androgen and cortisol metabolism. Ketosteroid. So androgen and the cortisol metabolism will lead to production of the 17-ketosteroid in the urine, which is the normal constituent. Next important abnormal constituent are the ethereal sulfate. Ethereal sulfate, which is also known as indicans. So indicans or the ethereal sulfates are like indoxyl, scatoxyl. Indoxyl or the scatoxyl. So these are the ethereal sulfates. Next important chemical constituent is the creatine. Normally creatine is present in the urine under the two physiological conditions. One is in case of children as well as in case of pregnancy, you can get normally creatine in the urine. But in other conditions such as myopathies, in case of starvation, where the muscle breakdown will occur, that will lead to increase concentration of the creatine in the urine, as well as in case of thyrotoxicosis. Thyrotoxicosis disease also, you can get abnormal creatine constituent in the urine. And finally, you have to know the culture sensitivity test. A little bit about the culture sensitivity. It is basically done to detect any specific bacterial manifestation in the urine, if it is there or not. And if it is positive, then which antibiotic is more sensitive to kill this bacteria or to treat this bacterial infection. In these circumstances, you will do the culture sensitivity test. Most typically or most commonly, you can encounter the E. coli, Escherichia coli infection whenever the patient will present with the UTI. And this E. coli is most commonly occur bacteria which can be present in the urine. And at that time, you can get pus cell concentration more than 10 per high power field also. So if you will get more than 10 high power field pus cells, you have to ask the patient to do culture sensitivity test. And if you will get, suppose, E. coli, then which antibiotic will be more sensitive against this E. coli, that you have to choose from the investigation report and treat the patient accordingly. So this is all about our renal function test to assess the kidney disease. In the next half, we will discuss about the procedure by which we can assess the functional status of the kidney. Thank you.